standard deviation tells us how much something varies. A deviation, how much it varies from the mean. So when we do a standard deviation, your calculator does give us your standard deviation. But I like you to see where it comes from. And like I said the other day when we did it, Monday, was Monday, right? Monday. When we did this on Monday, I want you to notice at the bottom, we divided by n. Then we divided by n minus 1. That gave you your sample standard deviation. Because in your calculator, you're going to get a population standard deviation. Right? You get this for the population, and you get a sample. And they're different. So what happens is this. When you take your sum of your squares, the difference of your squares, and you divide by n and take the square root, this gives us a population one. When you take the same information, same thing, and divide by n minus 1, that gives us a sample. Guys, this is what I want you to get out of this. Am I ever going to ask you to make this table? No. But I want you to see where your standard deviation comes from. Things go off the mean. Not everything falls exactly in the middle, right? We don't have all the same numbers for your data. Aren't they spread out? Some data is spread out more than others. Like, for instance, your test rates. Your test rates are not very spread out because I don't expect them to be. You're in honors class. You're taking a college-level class. I don't expect the same amount of zeros as I expect as 100s. They're not a normal curve. I expect more higher grades, don't I? I don't expect zeros in here. I don't expect 20s or 30s in here. But I do expect 95s, 96s, 98s, 100s. I do expect those. So your grades don't vary that much off the mean. If it was a regular class, yeah, I probably could get 20s and 30s and 100s in here. And they would have more variation off the mean. How much it varies off the mean is your standard deviation. And last year, what you should have looked at when you did standard deviation was you probably found a mean. So say the mean was 100. And they said your standard deviation is 10. That meant for every one standard deviation, and this was probably all you could basically do, it varied 10 points. So this was, or 10, whatever I've measured, 10 pounds. So this goes here. And this comes down 10. So my curve for information would go from 70 to 130. That's where I would expect my values to be. And things vary off the mean. Now, if your standard deviation, guys, you need to stay with me here, is higher, what does this do to this? Say my standard deviation is 20. So this is 120. This is 140. This is 160. Look at what's happening. 80, 60, 40. Look at my data now. Didn't we say one way to measure it was its range? This range is 130 minus 70, 60. This range is 160 minus 40, 120. So do you see like how things vary? They could vary a lot. They could be spread out. They could be close together. So we want to measure how much does this vary off the mean, which is why the first thing we did was take the mean of our data. This was key right here. What's the mean? I need to know what's the mean is. I need to know how much does this vary off the mean. That's what we did next. Didn't we subtract it from our mean? Didn't you get some positives and some negatives? Right? You got some positives, you got some negatives. It varied off the mean. Then we took the difference of those things and we squared them. Now we're working with your formula. So we take the sum of those squares, divide them by the amount of n. Take the square root, we get your standard deviation. Will you have to see this table again? No. Will you have to make this again? No. But I want you to understand where your standard deviation comes from. And when you look at the population and you look at the sample and you see there's a difference, I want you in your mind to say, we divide by n, we divide by n minus 1. And we're going to have situations where, remember sometimes you did a frequency and you put in the percent as a decimal? Some of you put in those decimals as L1. So if you put a decimal in, these are all decimals, they all have to add up to 1. So what happens now is, your calculator says, okay, divide by n. N is 1. But when you do a sample, divide by 1 minus 1, can you divide by 0? No. So when you use decimals in your L2 and they add up to 1, you won't get a sample standard deviation. So I want you to remember, oh, the reason I don't is because if I do 1 minus 1, I can't divide by 0. So that's my intent on showing you how to do a standard deviation. Plus, I left the calculator, but I need you to know why this works this way. I'm a big person on why does this happen? Well, show me why it works. So I want you to keep that in mind when we do standard deviations. I will never ask you to memorize this. I will never ask you to do this again. But I needed you to see where it comes from. Does it make sense? Questions on this at all? The rest is going right through your calculator, your L1 and your L2. And when you took Algebra 2, you did L1, L2, and got your standard deviation. But you did make this, but you did make that curve, didn't you? You put your standard deviations on it and calculate your percentages. We'll calculate our percentages a little different. A lot of movement going on in here, guys. All right, this is key. I want you to write this down somewhere. It's on, I think this is on your notes. Check to see if this is in your note page. Here's your normal curve.
Yeah.
Okay, make a normal curve like this. We started talking about your empirical rule the other day. I gave you two charts. One that came from with all the percentages in it, and one that came from an empirical rule. It kind of rounds it a little bit, so it gives it an estimate. So between 1 and negative 1 is 68% of your data. Between 2 and negative 2 is 95% of your data. 95% of your data. That's a lot of chunk of data. Between 3 and negative 3 is 99.7% of your data. Almost all of it. That means off those little tails, there's very, very little bit. This little area and this little area adds up to 0.3%. 0.3%. It's not a lot.
Is that
really
negative 3 and 99.7?
Yes, negative 3 to positive 3 is 99.7. This is called your empirical rule. We started to go over that chart. Okay, so now, this little statement is extremely important, as basic as it sounds. So don't pay attention, and every time I ask this, you'll get it wrong. So, data entries that lie more than 2 standard deviations away from the mean are considered unusual. So for instance, I gave you that test. The test average, let me just laid out there, is 80. The standard deviation was 10. So if you got, so let me put this like this, watch. There's an 80. So I go by tens. This is 90, this is 100, this is 110. This is 70, this is 60, this is 50. So if my average was 80 and my standard deviation is 10, if you got between a 60 and 100. That's where 95% of my data lies. If you got less than that, that's unusual for this class. If you got more than that, that'd be very unusual because that test didn't have a bonus in it. But if it did, it would be extremely unusual. So anything that goes past the twos on either side is unusual. Look how far away it is from the mean. Isn't that a pretty far distance from the mean? When we say the word unusual, not a real high-tech word, just unusual. If it lies more than 3 standard deviations away, that means you got less than a 50 or more than 110. We consider that very unusual. And we use these high-tech words, very unusual. Look how far away they are from the mean. They're very, very far away from the mean. So we consider that very unusual. I thought over the years they would come out with a better verbiage than unusual and very unusual, but they like those words. So anything, and consider that. The mean is in the middle. It's a normal curve. Everything is in the middle, mean, median, and mode. So anything that deviates away from that, too far away, is not normal, right? I want things close to the mean. That's what gives me my nice normal curve. Everything doesn't get a normal curve. One of the things that gets kind of a normal curve are your SAT scores. Why do you think your SAT scores give you more of a normal curve?
More of a normal curve?
Mm-hmm. Like I could expect some very low and some very high.
Okay,
everyone takes it. It is one of those tests that everyone takes. However, don't forget, kids that struggled all through school are probably not going to go to college. They're going to go learn a trade. They're not going to take it. They would be our further end, down on the bottom. And years ago, everybody had to take it, regardless if they went to college or not. Now, obviously, you take it if you're going to go to college. You don't want to take it if you're not going to. Like, if I don't plan to go to college after I'm finished with high school, I know what I want to be. I want to be a plumber. My dad's a plumber. My grandpa was a plumber. They're going to teach me how to be a plumber, and I don't need college for that. I don't need to take my SAT. The SAT, you have to pay for them?
I feel like the price never went down high.
Well, I had to pay like $9 because I had to pay the fee because I was like completely late.
Oh, you had a late.
I'm pretty sure with the essay and after I was like late or something, it came up like
$80.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, no, mine. Honestly, mine was so long ago, I have no idea what I paid or not. Mine was ages ago, but I did take an SAT. That's how long they've been around. Okay. They have been around for a very long time. They are one of those standardized testing that stays true to standards. Just because everybody takes it. And when we start working more with this, let me explain how this works. So I'm the dean at a college, and I'm the admissions dean. And I'm looking at everybody's SAT scores. So all my seniors from last year took the SATs. I want to know, like, what is the, I want the top 40% of all those scores. I don't want the bottom 40% of those scores. I want the top 40% of all those scores. So I kind of have to figure out what is my cutoff mark. What we're about to do, what we're going to be doing, will help me get my cutoff mark. I'll figure out where 40% lies above the mean, right? Because it's 50 on the top, 50 on the bottom. I want that a little bit above average and the higher one. I don't want the below average one. I'm going to make them take the test again. Let's go somewhere else. I'm a Harvard school. I want the top. Harvard probably wants the top 10%. And sometimes when you go to college, you take your SATs, you go to your admissions thing, they go have an interview, and they say to you, can you take your SATs again? And why do they want you to do that? Because you're probably teetering on the border. And yes, they do look at other things. They look at your grades. They look at your essays. They look at everything else. But they say, our cutoff is 1250. You have a 1220. I need you to get a 1250. So they will actually say that to students. We've had many students come back and retake that SAT. So, I mean, that is possible that they could do that. All right, so these are things that will help us figure out where that 40% lies, where those normal things lie. And SATs, again, probably still has a little bit of a skew to it, but not as much. All right, so now, guys, you seriously need to stop talking and need to be a little bit more focused. All right, see these graphs? They look better in your book than they do on my sheet. Page 87, if you will. So, this is how we interpret your standard deviations. Page 87. These are the graphs, but they don't look that great on my board. This is what I want you to remember about standard deviation. Standard deviation is a measure of the typical amount that an entry deviates from the mean. Standard deviation. It's got the word deviates. How much it goes away from the mean. Either direction. The more the entries are spread out, the greater the standard deviation. Makes sense, right? The closer the data, the smaller the standard deviation. Because there's not a lot of deviance from the mean. So keep that in mind when we look at this. So we're going to look at these three graphs. They look better in your book. So the first graph, they all have a mean of 5. Isn't their mean all the same? 5, it says it in your book right here. 5, 5, 5. All the means are 5. The standard deviation on the first one is 0. How come? All the things are 5. Did anything deviate off the mean? Did it go away from the mean? So it stayed at 5. So therefore our standard deviation, how much did things move away from the mean? It didn't. So it stayed at 5. So our standard deviation was 0. Over here, our standard deviation a little bit higher. But look, it still makes a nice normal curve. And does it go that far away from my mean? Not that far. So my standard deviation is 1.2. And you can kind of estimate where your standard deviation falls. We'll do that in a little bit. This guy, look where my mean is. My mean is still 5. But look how far my data goes away from my mean. Shouldn't that standard deviation be higher than the second one? Aren't these more spread out? This has that biggest spread here. So shouldn't my standard deviation be higher than this guy? And doesn't that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's look at these. Let's look at these guys. Notice they all have the same mean. Notice they all have the same mean. 4. They all have the same amount of n's. They all use 8. But they all have the same mean. Which one has the smallest standard deviation? The first one. Which one has the largest standard deviation? The third one. Why? It's more spread out. Jillian, put your phone away. I want your phones away. When I'm teaching, I want those phones away. Period. Or you'll get a 0 for the day. These are far more spread out than these, aren't they? These are a little spread out. It's still 4. Just because the mean is 4, do I have to have a value that's 4? Just because your average is 85, did you have to have a test value that was 85? So 85 could be 80, 80, 90, 90. Your 85 average. So I don't need to have that entry there. But they are a little bit spread out. These guys still a mean of 4, but they're very spread out. Okay, so that's what we're talking about when we talk about standard deviation. How far they're spread out from the mean. Let's see if they actually use this. So using your empirical rule. Again, you talk about your empirical rule. It should be on your paper as well. Isn't this in your paper? Your note paper? This is very, very, very important. This is where your data goes. We no longer give you that chart with all the Oh, the percentage is on it. We expect you to know this part. Because we figure out your standard deviation very different than you did in algebra 2. So we don't really use their chart, we use this chart. And we guesstimate. We know that half of your data is 50%. Half of your graph is 50%, right? So half of this 50 here, half of this 50 here. When we sketch, we're going to sketch normal curves. We're going to sketch a normal curve. We're going to put the mean in the middle. And we're going to say 1, 2, 3. Whose phone is that? Okay? The mean is always going to go in the middle. And the standard deviations are going to spread out. And we're going to see symmetry. Do we have symmetry? About the mean, right? Okay, that's how we're going to use this. Now, if you go take a look at, if all your data values are equal, just like we saw with that one big bar, your standard deviation is zero. If your data values are unequal, your standard deviation changes, but it never, your standard deviation itself is never a negative measure. If you think about it, standard deviation is like the distance away from the mean. And distance is always measured positive. Can I have a negative standard deviation that way? Yes, but my standard deviation itself is not negative. I could say I am at 10, which puts me at on the negative side, but my standard deviation is always measured positive. You'll see a little bit more as we do this. So let's do one. Do this with me, because you have to know how to do this. A survey conducted by the National Center for Health Statistics, the sample mean height for the women ages 20 to 29 is 64.2 inches. So we're going to pull out your information. With a sample standard deviation of 2.9 inches. You want to estimate the percent of the women whose height fall between 58.4 and 64.2 inches. I need to estimate this percentage of women that fall in between. Now, when we do this, we take a sample. We can't take every woman around here, and we project, we trend, we forecast. We set our estimate based on the standard deviation information. So everybody pick up a pencil. This is what I want you to put. Here's your mean. Pick up a pencil. Because if you ask me a question, I'm going to say, where's the one we did in class? Now, put your mean in the middle, 64.2. Your standard deviation is 2.9. So take 64.2 and add 2.9. At the 1, it's 67.1. Just put the values on top. This is what you have to write down. These are standard deviations away from the mean.
Wait, but isn't the mean 64.2?
Yes. Nope. There's your mean. 64.2. No, it's I technically put it to the side here. There's your X bar. I put it over here only because I didn't want to write in the words, but I see what you're saying. Let me see if I can move this. Let me see. I don't think I can move this.
You said it was a standard deviation.
No. This is your mean. I didn't want to write above here, so that is technically 64.2 is in the middle. Does that look better? Okay. Here's your mean. All right. So now, this is where our X values go. I'm a stickler about this. Your book is different than what I do. Don't do the book way. We put the standard deviation measures on the bottom. We put the X values, the real things we're working with, on the graph. Your book does it a little bit differently, but this is the way I do it. So 67.1, we add another standard deviation away. Add another 2.9. This is 70. Add another 2.9. So now we know our spread. Now, to go reverse, notice our standard deviation is a positive number. But now we're going to subtract it to go the opposite way, because your x values go in order from left to right. So we're going to start at 64.2 and subtract 2.9. This guy becomes 61.3. Subtract another 2.9. 58.4. I don't do mine like the book. This is 55.5. So our spread of data, our spread, our range of data from positive 3 to negative 3 goes from 55.5 to 72.9 inches. 99.7% of women in the United States aged 20 to 29, of all women in the United States, 99.7% of them will fall between 55.5 inches and 72.9 inches. Yeah, we'll find a few tall ones, and yeah, we'll find a few shorter ones. But that will be unusual, won't it? It will be very unusual. Most of them will fall between 55.5 and 72.9. Calculate how tall you are in here, girls. You're not 20 and 29 yet, but you probably stopped growing by 18, by 17, 18. God bless you. Your ages are in there. Now, God bless you. We want to estimate the percent. We want to estimate the percent of women. Hang in there, guys. Come on. That fall between 58.4. Here's my 58.4 and 64.2. Here's my 64.2. I want to estimate what percent is that. I have no percentages to add up. But I want to take an estimate first. Half of my graph is 50%. Is my estimate going to be more than 50% or less than 50%? Less. Jenny, why'd you say less? Good. If this is my half, it's not really the whole half. These are small. Another thing, we make them look wider because we have to have a bar. We have to fit our numbers in. Technically, that graph goes like this. It goes like this. These are where my threes are, right out here. This is where my two is, right out here. But we can't do that. We would not fit anything on there. So we exaggerate this curve. I want you to understand we exaggerate this when we draw it. Technically, that space is very, very small. Now, I don't know where those percents are, but I do know that plus or minus 2 is how much percent. Look back to what we wrote. Plus or minus 2 standard deviations is how much percent? 95% of my data. What part of 95% do I need to know? A third of it, a quarter of it, a half of it, none of it, all of it. A half of it. Aren't I just on one side of the curve? Guys, this is the most important part of this whole course. So what percent falls between 58.4 and 64.2 inches? Nick. 47.5%. And how did you get that?
Divided
95 by 2. Now, back in algebra 1, you had percentages in between here. This was 34.1. This was like 16 point something. And you just had to add them together. All you had to do was add them together. But we don't have that chart because we're going to do things a little bit differently. But right now, I want you to understand how the empirical rule works and how this graph works. So say I wanted to know the percent The next part is gonna ask you between 64.2 and 67.1. So, here's my 64.2, here's my 67.1. I wanna know what percent that is. So see if you can tell me what percent that is. Writing this down, guys, because this is pathetic if you're not. I want to know what percent falls between 64.2 inches and 67.1. How much? What percentage of U.S. women ages 20 to 29? Noah. 34%. Good. How did you get 34%? Okay, so Noah said plus or minus one standard deviation is 68%. Noah only wants half of it, so he divided it by 2, 34%. We're only working with your empirical rule. He said plus or minus 1 is 68%. That's the data we just gave you before. So I only want one part of it, 68%. Well, this whole thing is 68% because I just gave this to you before. So now I only want half of the whole 68%. So I don't want this piece right here, right? I only want this piece. So if this whole thing is 68%, I only want half, 34%. Okay? Using this chart, what percentage of women fall between 58.4 inches and 70 inches? What percentage fall between 58.4 inches and 70 inches? Jillian. Okay. Vernon.
95.
Good. So Vernon said from here to here. From negative 2 to positive 2. There's your empirical rule. What is it from plus or minus 2? 95%. How about this? What percentage of women are over 64.2 inches? What percentage of women are over 64.2 inches? Fred. What percentage of women are over 64.2 inches? Where is 64.2 inches on that messy graph? In the middle. So how much is half of your curve? It's half of 100. 50. So the right half of the curve is 50%. The left half of the curve is 50%. So how much is greater than? 50%. If I want to know how much is greater than, isn't this 50%? Is that half my curve? Half my curve. Half my curve. Okay, one more. Let's see if I can get this, all this crappy stuff out of here. Okay, what percentage of women was a tough one. What percentage of women are over 72.9 inches? Because I only want this little piece right here. We exaggerate that little tiny piece. But from 3 to negative 3 is 99.7. These guys add up to 0.3%, don't they?
Yeah.
And I only want this piece right here, half of it. Technically, 0.15%.
How do you know negative 33 is 99?
because I gave it to you, that's your empirical rule. Plus or minus 1 is 68, plus or minus 2 is 95, plus or minus 3 is 99.7. That you have to memorize. Otherwise, you can't do this.
Is that
it's on your chart in your note page.
This one says the last one's 2.25. Don't look at these guys. It's only going that's from here to here. That's from here to here. But from here to here is here to here.
Oh, that's...
See, these are very exact. See where the 2 and the 3 are? The 1 is just much of your date. We exaggerate this part because we can't get anything to do that. So, technically, that's how small this is. Remember when I just threw a 4 and I said 2 and 3? That's how small that is over there. Alright, so tomorrow we're going to be cleaning. Guys, tomorrow we'll continue with this, but if you don't get this, you are going to be so lost.